Hello, everyone. So we are here with Arthur in Montreal for the HackerOne Advisory Board meeting. And he agreed to not only have an interview with me for the podcast, but also show us a great bug, actually more than one bug, about Java deserialization. We'll start by saying like how to discover it, how to notice it in a little bit different way. That is the most common giveaway. And also how to bypass it, what to do if your YSO server that doesn't work. Hello, Arthur. Thank you so much for joining me for the explanation. And can you please start by telling us what made you think there's a deserialization going on? Because that is a specific bug class where you only hunt for it when you have a suspicion it exists.
Well, thank you for having me and thank you for the invite. I was really, really excited about this interview. So in this specific case, it was really awesome. This case, I found this domain and subdomain, and I do some fuzzing. After fuzzing, I found this specified path with the older application inside this path. And after seeing this application, I saw some requests, and this request has some curious object in the path. So I'm not only looking for this kind of vulnerability, but when I saw this object, my eyes, probably here has good thing, and I will work in that. So what I see on the path was they start H4S. So this is a good thing to use. Stay worried when you are looking for deserialization vulnerabilities, because this start is you have this start when you have some Java object, and after this Java object has been compressed by JZip, and after compressed by JZip, you have encoded in base 64, and this object H4S probably will be a Java object.
So yeah, it's a little less common one than RO0, which is the typical, but without the compression.
Yeah, it's because there is a compression in C. Yeah. So if in this case didn't have any compression, the path probably will be R0 in
exactly.
This case.
Yeah. Which, of course, from our perspective, from the vulnerability perspective, doesn't make any difference.
Yeah.
Just one more step for exploiting it.
Yeah. So you, in this case, you only need, when you are using the YSO zero, an example, if you are using the YSO zero command, you pipe with the JZip, Bash, and pipe to JZip, and after that pipe to base64, and you have the payload. So in that case, I really like an extension called Java deserialization scanner to Burp switch. I like this extension because I use when I have some this kind of vulnerability, I can use that, and you need to set in the extension the path to your YSO zero. And with that extension, you have more abilities, and you have a graphical interface to deal with the serialization. So I like that you are capable to set the insertion points or the place to the Java object in the extension, and you are capable to get to set the YSO zero command extension too. So in this case of this report, I set URL DNS with my RBind server only to get the result of this request. So
basically, this extension under the hood still uses YSO serial.
Yeah, it's a graphical interface.
It's just easier to use this.
Yeah,
just through Burp.
It's better. Help if you didn't like use command a lot. So I like because I have this graphical interface. I can send to Burp Suite the request. So this is important to me because sometimes when you copy the object from the terminal, sometimes maybe it's not right or object is not complete. So you can use this extension to get the request complete on the Burp Suite. So I use a lot of Burp Suite and maybe combine these two things. And in that case, I have the JZip compress. So I set the insertion point, put the gadget, the YSO zero gadgets in the extension, compressing using JZip, and after that encoding by base64, send the request, and we have the
callback.
We have the RF band. So this is a good way of get this they exploit these scenarios. There's another thing here. Some cases when you have some problems with encoding an example. You have slashes and plus and equal. In this case, it's important. In this case, what was important to encode these chars because the payload was not process it in the right way if you didn't code discharge. So I encode the discharge and the break lines too. I encode change to I didn't know the name, but this distrust.
Yeah. So sometimes callback is enough to, well, it's enough to prove the deserialization, and sometimes it's enough to get the report triage, but sometimes the program requires us to go further, and it's not always as easy.
Yeah, yeah. This case was easy, and the triage and the team agree, you don't need to go more far, because we know you are deserialization, you proved this to us, and this is a critical vulnerability, but sometimes
it's rewarded as a 10 out of 10 critical. Nice.
Yeah. So the vulnerability was triggered by with the CVSS 10.
Yeah,
so
it's lovely.
Yeah, it's a really good sensation.
Also, sorry to keep you waiting, but finally I can announce that again it's possible to get access to case studies, the Oath course, and the DevTools course. The link is in the description.
Sometimes when you are facing this Java deserialization vulnerabilities, you are able to access some gadgets like JMAP client. Yeah. It's another gadget on CSOCR, so you can use these gadgets to try understand if you are deserialization or not, if deserialization is occurring or not in the backend of the application. But sometimes there is some way to fix, but to fix the serialization using the Lookahead object input.
Lookahead object input.
Yeah.
I've never encountered this, to be honest.
Yeah. So sometimes when an example, you try URL DNS works, you try JMAP clients, it works because you have a timeout. This gadget is interesting because you didn't receive out of band with URL DNS, but you can receive some connection from the sev, or you can see if you receive a timeout, because sometimes your servers are blocked. Yeah. And if you use JMAP client to test deserialization, probably if the servers are blocked or any TCP connection out of band are blocked, you will be receiving timeout or 10 seconds or 12 seconds, 11 seconds. An example, the page needs 200 milliseconds to load, but when you use that payload, GMRPC client, the page needs 10 seconds to load or 11 seconds to load, because probably the Java is trying to connect in your server or something, and the connection didn't work, but probably the deserialization is happening here. And you have this gadgets working, but the other classes like common collections or other things are not working, and probably there is some fix here, or maybe they use some fix using Lookahead object input, because with this fix, what Java is going to do is check if the class is allowed to deserialization or not. Yeah. So this is what this fix do. It's every time, because when you have a Java object, you have the name of the class. So with this method, you check the name of the class. Oh, this is a malicious class. It's not in our allowlist. And this, if it's not in our allowlist, probably is a malicious gadget. You will not deserialize this guy.
Yeah.
So when we have these problems, a good way to bypass this is using a repository called Serial Killer Bypass Gadget Collection. It's a good way to bypass, because what is happening here is this guy called Alvaro Munoz. This guy has a lot of, I think this guy has more reports, not only in Java, but in .NET deserialization, I think. I don't know, but I remember to see anything like that. So this guy has this repository with a lot of bypass. And these bypass are using native libraries to, like a bridge, because when you are when Lookahead method will check if you, the gadget, the class is allowed or not to deserialization, you have the bypass class in the front, and when the Lookahead method will check, oh, this gadget is okay, when deserialization will happen, you will be execute not the allowed class, but the malicious gadget with the class, and you can reach the remote code execution.
So does this look ahead fix, does it look at, let's say we create an object of allow listed class.
Okay.
Does it also look at what objects does this class create, or does it only look at the first one?
Yeah, probably it's the first one.
Okay.
The first one. So.
So we only need like one bridge here.
Yeah.
And then once we are there, we can do whatever we want.
Probably maybe can be more complicated than we are talking about. Maybe it's that. Look the first. If the first is allowed, okay, you can pass. And this first can be used to call all the other gadgets.
Yeah. Cool.
So and the gadgets are in the code of the application, because the associated gadgets are really code and native in the library. So yeah. These codes are only used to get the remote code execution. So this is the reason why exists a lot of common collections, 2, 3, 4, I think there is a lot, because these common collections may be working different versions of Java.
Yeah.
And you can, probably if you have a YOSOSIR and you have a possible deserialization vulnerability, you try all to see all.
Usually you do.
Yeah. You try all the same thing with the serial killer bypass gadgets collection. I showed to you that example.
Yeah.
We use the command ping, and with the ping we use ping gadget class gadget bypass in our out of band server, and we create a Python script with all the useful serial gadgets and the other the bypass in this. The serial killer,
yeah.
And we write all the commands to generate all the payloads and send the intruder. And after that, we just save a lot of ping with all the bypass working in the web server.
Yeah, so you have the RCE. Was this one also rewarded as a 10 out of 10 critical?
Yeah, so this case I showing to you, it was more funny because it was a engagement, and after that we create a lot of we need to deal with the SOC, because we are working in a pen test and deal with the SOC and have a lot of bypass to SOC and buy new domains because they are blocking our domains. they are blocking our domains. We need to up new AWS instance, buy new domains, because the idea is if the SOC team allow us to continue when we try to close the contract with the Brazilian, all these are allowed tests, and we are dealing with the SOC because the idea is we didn't have any help from the SOC. We do all these things by passing the SOC and all we can do there. So our out of band, our blockhead, we need to is few, because we only have out of band and didn't have persistence at that time. So we use some commands complexes to an example, read some file, compress in the zip, using XCD to convert in hexadecimal, and a loop to break, and step by step send to our server, and we do the reverse process to get out the file and the command.
Cool.
Yeah, it was really, really cool.
Very cool. Thank you so much for going through it. If you enjoyed it, make sure to subscribe to also watch our full interview that will be published 2 weeks after this video. For now, thank you so much for watching, and goodbye.